From the notes of Dr. Malcolm Long, October 25th, 1985. First interview with Kovacs. Okay, now I guess you know what this is. He's even more disturbed than I'd heard, but I'm optimistic. A success here could make my reputation. I want you to look at it and tell me what you see. He's very withdrawn, with no expression in either face or voice. Getting a response is often difficult. Will you look at it, Walter? Will you do that for me? Physically, he's fascinatingly ugly. I could stare at him for hours, except that he stares back, which I find uncomfortable. Nevertheless, I'm convinced I can help him. No problem is beyond the grasp of a good psychoanalyst. Well, Walter, what is it? A pretty butterfly. His responses to the Rorschach blot tests were surprisingly bright and positive and healthy. I really think he might be getting better. I just wish he wouldn't stare at me like that. His full name is Walter Joseph Kovacs, born 1940. Mother's name, Sylvia Joanna Kovacs, formerly Sylvia Glick. His father's name is unknown. Let's try another, shall we? How about this one? He's 5 feet 6 inches tall and weighs 140 pounds. For his age, he's in excellent physical shape. The police have beaten on him pretty badly. During the police strike of 77, he made several inflammatory anti-cop statements, and they've never forgotten. The cops don't like him, the underworld doesn't like him, nobody likes him. I've never met anyone quite so alienated. Come on, Walter. Do it for me, huh? Walter? How on earth did he get like this? Okay, Walter. Now, I want you to tell me what's on the card. Tell me what you see.
Hey, what is this? Oh, God. You didn't tell me you had no kids around here. I get enough of this crap at home.
Oh, baby, please listen. He's kind of backwards. Please, don't get mad.
Here's $5. It's more than you're worth.
$5? You bastard!
Get out of my way, retard.
Mom, I'm sorry. I thought he was hurting you.
You little shit!
You know what you just cost me?
Mommy!
Well, Walter, what do you make of it?
Some nice flowers.
Wonderful. Walter, I'm very pleased with your responses. I really think there's hope, don't you? Ah, well, okay, Walter. I think that's enough for today. I'll see you tomorrow.
Hey! Hey, Rorschach! Yeah. You dead, man!
Rorschach!
Hit you, Rorschach!
Rorschach!
In 1951, he attacked an older child, partially blinding him with a lighted cigarette. He was 10 years old. Once his home life had been investigated, he was put into care. He seemed to improve. Excelling at schoolwork, Kovacs grew into a bright but unusually quiet child. Even in 1956, when informed of his mother's brutal murder, he restricted his comments to one word. Good. Good morning, Walter. Today, I'd like... Oh, sorry, late night. Today, I'd like to do something different. Frankly, Walter, I'd like to talk about Rorschach. Will you do that for me, Walter? Will you tell me about Rorschach?
You keep calling me Walter. I don't like you.
You don't like me? All right. We're... Why is that exactly?
Fat, wealthy, think you understand pain. I'll tell you something, Doctor. I'll tell you about Rorschach. 1956, aged 16, left children's home, became unskilled manual worker. Job bearable but unpleasant. Had to handle female clothing. 1962, special order for dress in new Dr. Manhattan spin-off fabric. Viscous fluids between two layers latex. Customer, young girl, Italian name. Never collected order. Said dress looked ugly. Wrong. Not ugly at all. Black and white. Moving. Changing shape. Very, very beautiful. Nobody wanted it, meant for me. Took it home. Learned to cut it using heated implements. Soon became bored. Fabric had no use. 2 years passed. Stopped at newsstand on way to work, bought paper. There she was. Woman who'd ordered special dress, Kitty Genovese. Raped, tortured, killed. Outside her own apartment building. Almost 40 neighbors heard screams. Nobody did anything. Nobody called cops. Some of them even watched. Do you understand? Some of them even watched. I knew what people were then. Behind all the evasions, all the self-deception, ashamed for humanity, I went home. I took the remains of her unwanted dress and made a face that I could bear to look at in the mirror.
A face, I see. Walter, is what happened to Kitty Genovese really proof that the whole of mankind is rotten? There are good people too, like...
Like you?
Me? Oh, well, I wouldn't say that,
No, you just think it. Why are you spending so much time with me, Doctor?
Because I care about you. And I want to make you well.
Other people down in cells, behavior more extreme than mine. But then, they're not famous. You don't want to make me well. Just want to know what makes me sick. Have patience, Doctor. You'll find out.
Of course, what we have here is a classic case of misdirected aggression. Kovacs hated his mother. After her death, he needed somewhere to put the anger, and so he chose the criminal fraternity. The flimsy story about Kitty Genovese is obviously there to justify his behavior to himself. It's perfectly simple. Case solved. You'll find out. I wonder what he meant.
John Adams was America's second president and first vice president. He worked with Thomas Jefferson in helping to draft the Declaration of Independence. While it does not appear that Adams was a member of any secret group, he was a Unitarian and shared views against Christianity, much like the other revolutionaries. John Adams is often portrayed, in fact, I have friends of mine who are Christians, who will tell you that Adams was a Christian man. And Adams, there are a number of quotes from Adams where he talks about Christian principles and so on, and how he believes that it was Christian principles that brought about the founding of the United States. But Adams did not mean that the United States was founded on Christian principles alone, but rather on a mix of Christian and pagan philosophies. He said, "These are what are called revolution principles. They are the principles of Aristotle and Plato, the principles of nature and eternal reason." Adams wrote that the general principles on which the fathers achieved independence were the general principles of Christianity. In favor of these general principles, in philosophy, religion, and government, I could fill sheets of quotations from Rousseau and Voltaire.
Adam's reference to Rousseau and Voltaire is strange, to say the least, since these two Enlightenment thinkers were both well known for their anti-Christian views. Voltaire, in particular, wanted the end of Christianity. He wrote that Christianity is the most ridiculous, the most absurd, and bloody religion that has ever infected the world. He also said, "It took 12 ignorant fishermen to establish Christianity. I will show the world how one Frenchman can destroy it." By combining the principles of Christianity with Voltaire, it is as though Adams is saying that the general principles of the founding of America were both the principles of God and the devil at the same time. With this in mind, consider that Adams once wrote to Thomas Jefferson, "I should have given my reason for rejoicing in Voltaire and company. It is because I believe they have done more to propagate religious liberty than Calvin or Luther." Voltaire and Rousseau were so closely associated with the American founders that they are shown in this image beside Benjamin Franklin, as if they all represented the same ideals. But when men like Voltaire spoke about liberty, the freedom they wanted was to be free from Christianity. Is it possible that such a view influenced men like John Adams? The answer largely depends on how you define Christianity.
If you study the founding fathers and the Enlightenment thinkers of this era, it's important to pay attention to the word religion. Okay? Because the word religion to them has to do with a framework of morality. When they say religion, they don't mean what we would mean today as Bible-believing Christians in the world today. What they mean by religion is just a system of conduct, really. They don't mean the testimony that Jesus is the Son of God and so on.
And so, for men like John Adams, the Christian religion did not mean the gospel. Even in his lifetime, Adams himself knew full well that his doctrinal views were rejected by Orthodox Christians. He said to them, famously, "Ye will say, I am no Christian. I say, ye are no Christians." And there, the account is balanced. As said before, Adams was a Unitarian, and the Unitarian belief specifically rejects the doctrine of the Christian Trinity, the idea of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Adams wrote that the Pythagorean as well as the Platonic philosophers probably concurred in the fabrication of the Christian Trinity. Furthermore, Adams did not believe that Jesus was the Son of God or that he was God manifest in the flesh. He said, "The Europeans are all deeply tainted with prejudices which they can never get rid of. They are all infected with creeds and confessions of faith. They all believe that great principle which has produced this boundless universe came down to this little ball to be spit upon by Jews. And until this awful blasphemy is got rid of, there never will be any liberal science in the world." The reason Adams rejected the doctrine that Jesus is God was because of his view that God is unknowable, and therefore, for the Bible to say that the person of God was revealed in Jesus Christ was to him an awful blasphemy. Adams wrote to Jefferson that when we say God is a spirit, we know what we mean. Let us be content, therefore, to believe him to be a spirit, that is, an essence that we know nothing of. But where did Adams get his belief? The pagan origin of his faith was revealed by him in a letter to Thomas Jefferson, where he made reference to an allegedly 5,000-year-old Indian book, the Shasta, the first book of Brahmin theology. He said, "Where is to be found theology more orthodox or philosophy more profound than in the introduction to the Shasta? God is one, creator of all, universal sphere. Search not the essence and the nature of the eternal who is one. Your research will be vain and presumptuous. The eternal willed to communicate of his essence and of his splendor to beings capable of perceiving it. The eternal willed, and he created Burma, Vitznau, and Sib. These doctrines, Adam says, sublime if ever there were any sublime, Pythagoras learned in India. In contrast to Adam's belief that God cannot be known, in the Bible, Jesus said, "And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent." In Hosea, God says, "For I desired mercy and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings." And while Adam Shasta says it is vain to seek God, Jesus said, "Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth, and he that seeketh, findeth. And to him that knocketh, it shall be opened." It was during the presidency of John Adams that the much-debated Treaty of Tripoli was signed. The treaty bears, perhaps, the most contrary statement against the idea of the United States as a Christian nation.
And the Treaty of Tripoli is, I think, the clearest declaration that the original founders of the United States of America did not believe that they were setting forth a Christian nation. Why? Because they specifically said so in this treaty. And what you have are patriots, diehard patriots, who will try to spin the Treaty of Tripoli and somehow or other state that it doesn't mean what it says. But there's no, if you read the entire treaty, there's no reason for them to come right out and say that the government of the United States of America is not in any sense founded on the Christian religion. There's no reason to say that if they don't mean it. So they declare this, and according to the history, it was unanimously agreed to on the floor of the Senate. Now, why was it unanimously agreed to? The question, of course, is, well, wait a minute, where were all the Christian founders to leap to their feet and to lift up a shout against this treaty once they heard it? You would think that there would be at least one Christian who would have jumped up and said something. The answer seems to come from a Christian man named Dr. Bird Wilson. And Bird Wilson was somebody who had spent years of his life investigating the faith of the founding fathers.
In a famously controversial sermon he preached in 1831, Dr. Wilson said, "The founders of our nation were nearly all infidels. When the war was over, the Constitution was framed and God was neglected. He was not merely forgotten. He was absolutely voted out of the Constitution. The proceedings, as published by Thompson, the secretary, show that the question was gravely debated whether God should be in the Constitution or not. And after a solemn debate, he was deliberately voted out of it." Dr. Wilson went on to say that those who have been called to administer the government have not been men making any public profession of Christianity.
And he's saying this in the early part of the 19th century. It's important to remember, not all of the Christians, you know, when the American Revolution happened, the impression of many church leaders was not that this was a Christian revolution. The impression of many leaders was not that the revolutionaries were Christians who were somehow or other following the example of Jesus and the apostles by launching this revolution.
The absence of Christians in the early American government would explain why no one objected to Article 11 of the Treaty of Tripoli. Yet while this treaty was confirmed under President John Adams, the origin of Article 11 may represent the unkindest cut of all. According to 19th century historian Moncure D. Conway, the controversial Article 11 was drafted by none other than George Washington. Conway said, "President Washington, the first time he ever came in treaty with a non-Christian people, Tripoli, sent to the Senate a treaty which opened with the following: As the government of the United States of America is not in any sense founded on the Christian religion." There is the statement, Conway says, from the great Washington. The Treaty of Tripoli was drafted toward the end of Washington's presidency and then confirmed under John Adams. If Washington himself authored Article 11, it would further explain why no one would dare to question it. But also compels us, as we continue this journey, to investigate the real faith of the man who was at the heart of the American Revolution.
Hey, Rorschach, you're pretty famous, right? Boy, you know, I'd sure like your autograph. I got my autograph book right here in my pocket. The guards intervened, dragging Kovacs away to solitary and the other man to the prison hospital. As they dragged him away, Rorschach spoke to the other inmates. He said, "None of you understand. I'm not locked up in here with you. You're locked up in here with me." My earlier optimism was obviously unfounded. He's getting worse. So am I. Just read back what I've written above. The sixth line down should read, "Kovacs spoke to the other inmates." Kovacs, not Rorschach. 1975 kidnap case, perhaps you remember. Blair Roche, 6 years old. Kidnappers believed she was connected to Roche chemical fortune. Stupid mistake, father was bus driver, no money at all. Days dragged by, no word from kidnappers. Thought of little child, abused, frightened. Didn't like it, personal reasons. Decided to intervene. Promised parents I'd return her unharmed. Visited underworld bars and began hurting people. Put 14 in hospital needlessly. 15th gave me an address. Disused dressmakers in Brooklyn. Bad neighborhood. Smelled of damp plaster and stained mattresses. Arrived there at dusk, no lights on in building. Something was making noise in wasteland at rear. Attack dogs. Two German shepherds fighting over a knob of bone. Didn't seem interested in me.
shock of impact ran along my arm. Jet of warmth spattered on chest like hot faucet. It was Kovacs who said mother then, muffled under latex. It was Kovacs who closed his eyes. It was Rorschach who opened them again. According to my informant, man using premises named Gerald Grice. Out drinking when I called, returned to dressmakers at 10:45. Dark by then, dark as it gets.
Hello, Fred. Barney, I'm home. Come on, who's got a bark for daddy? Anything. I swear. I... Get off! Somebody get it off me! Oh, no. Oh, please. I haven't done anything. Oh, wait. Look. I know what you think. You think I'm something to do with that little girl. Well, you can't prove anything. I mean, where's the evidence? You can't do anything to me. Hey, wait a minute. That's mine. Look, please, if you just say something. Hey, are you crazy? That's kerosene!
Yes. Shouldn't bother trying to saw through handcuffs. Never make it in time.
What do you mean? Am I supposed to... Oh, God. Oh, Jesus, no! You're kidding! You have to be kidding!
Stood in street, watched it burn. Imagined limbless felt torsos inside, breasts blackening, bellies smoldering, bursting into flame one by one. Watched for an hour. Nobody got out. Stood in firelight, sweltering, bloodstain on chest like map of violent new continent. Felt cleansed, felt dark planet turn under my feet. And knew what cats know that makes them scream like babies in the night. Looked at sky through smoke, heavy with human fat. And God was not there. The cold, suffocating dark goes on forever, and we are alone. Live our lives, lacking anything better to do. Devise reason later. Born from oblivion, bear children hell-bound as ourselves, go into oblivion. There is nothing else. Existence is random, has no pattern save what we imagine after staring at it for too long. No meaning save what we choose to impose. This rudderless world is not shaped by vague metaphysical forces. It is not God who kills the children, not fate that butchers them, or destiny that feeds them to the dogs. It's us, only us. Streets stank of fire. The void breathed hard on my heart, turning its illusions to ice, shattering them. Was reborn then. Free to scrawl own design on this morally blank world, was Rorschach. Does that answer your questions, Doctor?
Whatever was left of Walter Kovacs died that night with that little girl. was only Rorschach. See, Dr. God didn't kill that little girl. Fate didn't butcher her. Destiny didn't feed her to those dogs. God saw what any of us did that night. He didn't seem to mind. From then on, I know. God doesn't make the world this way. We do.